21 as we continue to talk about our Lord's Passion Week and him witnessing inside the temple. Now, we know he's in Mount of Olives, where he is now outside of the temple, given this discourse specifically only to his disciples when they asked him about when will these things be. In Luke, it is recorded that they are asking about the destruction of the temple and the Lord's second coming, where in Mark and Matthew, the parallel passages are just in regard to the second coming of our Lord. This is known as the Olivet Discourse in Matthew and Mark. Luke then gives a little bit more information about the destruction of Jerusalem and the temple, as you know, that occurred in 70 AD. So here we are finding ourselves in chapter 21 in verses 8 through 11, where it's the prophecy of the birth pains of the end times. And we find ourselves in chapter 9. It says, "And when you hear of wars and disturbances," and the other two parallel passages say wars and rumors of wars, but here it's wars and disturbances, "do not be terrified, for these things must take place first, but the end does not follow immediately." And then he continued by saying to them, "Nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom." And then in verse 11, it goes into even more detail. But what we have in verses 9 and 10 specifically are in regard to the second seal judgment. Actually, the second seal judgment. I've been studying all the seals lately, so I'm getting a little caught up in that. But in any case, this is the second seal judgment when the red horse rider comes onto the scene bringing a sword. And again, bringing about warfare onto the world and ultimately bringing a world war, as we would maybe call it today, World War III, if there isn't a World War III before then. But ultimately, World War III, if it happens in our near future, where the Antichrist will be attacked by other countries and nations as he tries to take control of the entire world. And so in this second seal judgment of the six seal judgments in the book of Revelation in chapter 6, we note that this second horse rider comes on the red horse, and ultimately the number 2 means he brings division into the world. And here it's division man against man, because they have been divided from a relationship with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ due to their unbelief. So the imagery of division is throughout all of this, but man turning his hand upon man in a great world war conflict that we began to note on Tuesday, and we're going to finish up this evening. And as we recall, the first horse rider coming out under the first seal judgment represents the Antichrist coming onto the scene. And as we know, he comes with a bow and he comes to conquer and conquering. Basically, he comes with a bow of peace, the rainbow, as it were, but also the weaponry, a bow, the archer's bow, bringing about the weapons, because he will arise from a 10 nation federation, where then 3 of those nations, he will overthrow the leaders of 3 of them, thereby gaining power over the entire federation. We know that to be the revived Roman Empire when we are comparing scripture with scripture, and specifically going back into the book of Daniel, which we're going to do tonight. But this is what we call the revived Roman Empire. It comes out of that European Union that is in existence today. So we see these things beginning to form in our day. And in that, he will be a great world leader, bringing about peace with Israel and the Israelites, but then turning against them in the second half of the tribulation. But in the process, not only taking power of the revived Roman Empire, then he will set his sights on the rest of the world, but there will be other sovereign nations that will rise up against him, and other sovereign federations that will rise up against him, trying to destroy his one world rule. But as we've been noting, he will conquer them initially and take them all over, and then utilize those powers to turn them against Israel towards the end, and then also against our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ in the battle of Armageddon. So let's turn in our Bibles. Let's go to Daniel chapter 7, where we see Daniel prophesying in regard to these events and things. So again, turning back in our Bibles, again, going to kind of towards the second third of the Old Testament, when we are into the major prophets. Again, Daniel being towards the end of those major prophets, after Isaiah and Ezekiel and Jeremiah. But in Daniel chapter 7, when we specifically look at the beginning part, verses 7 and 8, it speaks to this conflict and what is going on. So, let's go back to verse 4, and I'll give you just a little bit of context here. And again, this is the vision that Daniel had received and the interpretation in regard to the end times prophecies. It says the first, again, speaking of the types of nations that would rise, the first was like a lion and had the wings of an eagle, and it kept looking until its wings were plucked, and it was lifted up from the ground and made to stand on 2 feet like a man, a human mind also was given to it. And behold, another beast, a second one, resembling a bear. And it was raised up on one side, and 3 ribs were in the mouth between the teeth. And thus they said to it, arise, devour much meat. After this I kept looking, and behold, another one, like a leopard, which had on its back 4 wings of a bird. The beast also had 4 heads, and dominion was given to it. And that's what we would call the Greek Empire as we understand. Now in verse 7, and after this I kept looking in the night vision, and behold, a 4th beast, dreadful and terrifying and extremely strong. That would be the Roman Empire. And it had large iron teeth. It devoured and crushed and trampled down the remainder with its feet. And it was different from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. Okay, and that gets us now into the revived Roman Empire understanding. It says, while I was contemplating the horns, behold, another horn, a little one, came up among them. And 3 of the 1st horns were pulled out of the roots before it. And behold, this horn possessed eyes like the eyes of a man, and mouth uttering great boasts. And then it goes on, and he gets into a little bit of a narrative. But I want you to now skip down down to verse 20, where it picks up once again. But looking at it in verse 19, it says, then I desired to know the exact meaning of the 4th beast, which was different from all the others, exceedingly dreadful, with its teeth of iron and its claws of bronze, and which devoured, crushed, and trampled down the remainder with its feet. Talk about all the other empires that had come along. And remember, this is kind of analogous to the statue that Daniel saw in the early chapters of the book of Daniel, when it talked about the various kingdoms, the Babylonian, the Medo-Persian, and then the Greek Empire, and then the Roman Empire coming onto the scene. And then, as we recognize, the revived Roman Empire of the 10 toes made of iron and clay. All right, so that's why this one's different, this iron beast, again, or this 4th beast, different from all the rest. And the meaning of the 10 horns that were on the head, on its head, and the other horn which came up, and before which 3 of them fell, namely that horn which had eyes and a mouth uttering great boasts, and which were larger in appearance than its associates. And again, the great boast is he is now claiming, I am God, I am the Christ. And again, the great blaspheme of the Antichrist during the tribulation, saying that he is the God of gods, as it were. Now in verse 21, I kept looking, and that horn was waging war with the saints, again, believers, and overpowering them, until the Ancient of Days came and judgment was passed in favor of the saints of the highest one. And the time arrived when the saints took possession of the kingdom. And again, that's the second advent of Jesus Christ, where he comes back, wipes out the Antichrist and his world forces, and then establishes the millennial reign. Again, the saints took possession of the kingdom. Now in verse 23, thus he said, the fourth beast will be a fourth kingdom on earth, which will be different from all the other kingdoms, and it will devour the whole earth and tread it down and crush it. As for the ten horns, out of this kingdom ten kings will arise, and another will arise after them, and he will be different from the previous ones, and will subdue three kings. And he will speak out against the Most High, and wear down the saints of the Most of the Highest One. And he will intend to make alterations in times and in law, and they will be given into his hand for a time, times, and half a times. And at the end there, time, times, and half a times. One time is a year, two times is another. And then again, the third, again, 3.5 years are in view. Time, times, and a half a times, talking about the 3.5 years that will be the last 3.5 years of the tribulation. But then it goes on to say, but the court will sit for judgment, and his dominion will be taken away, annihilated, and destroyed forever. Then the sovereignty of the dominion and the greatness of all the kingdoms under the whole heaven will be given to the people of the saints of the Highest One. And again, this is the Jewish kingdom led by Jesus Christ in the millennial reign. His kingdom will be an everlasting kingdom, and all the dominions will serve and obey him. At this point, the revelation ended. As for me, Daniel, my thoughts were greatly alarming me, and my face grew pale. But I kept the matter to myself. So, again, the great vision that was given to Daniel in regard to the Antichrist that would come out of that Roman Empire, and really the revived Roman Empire, as we compare Scripture with Scripture and understand it. And all of this also correlates with what it says in Revelation chapter 13, verse 5, where the Antichrist will take that rulership and authority, and to maintain that, he will be threatening the people with death over and over and over again. And in fact, when we know about that, the number of the beast called 666, which will be some form of either tattoo, or maybe it's a chip implanted, or maybe it's just some kind of other insignia that is either on the hand or the forehead, people will be forced to receive that under the penalty of death. But yet, even when they receive it, they will have to know full well that if they do receive it, they will be ultimately rejecting Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, because it also says whoever receives the mark of the beast cannot be saved. So they will have a conscious decision: either accept the Antichrist as their leader and ruler and their God, or reject him and be put to death, be martyred, because instead they would be believing in the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And if people take on the mark of the beast, they will be put to death. And if they don't take on the mark of the beast, they will be put to death. But if they do take the mark of the beast, they will be subjected to him. And even though that happens, and as he tries to not only take over the European Union called the Revived Roman Empire, which he is successful in doing, then he will set his sights towards the rest of the world. But then the second seal will be opened up by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and the Red Horse Rider will come along to meddle in the affairs of the world, where again other sovereign governments will rise up against the Antichrist, because they will not want him ruling over them, even though most of the world is now ruled by him. And they will then bring up warfare against him, but as we've said, he will defeat them in the initial warfare, and they will then be subjected to him as a result. So all of this is in regard to the Antichrist and what he will take on in authority during the tribulational time period. And then the Red Horse Rider comes along and rises up the other nations to come to war against him, but they will be defeated. But that too was part of the judgment against the world, man turning upon man, a World War III, as it were, and again getting the deserts of their rejection of Jesus Christ as their Savior and as their Messiah. And he will, again, the Antichrist will take over, rule, and he will reign for a short period of time, but then at the end, Jesus Christ comes back victoriously. As it says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 3, it says, while they are saying peace and safety, then destruction will come upon them suddenly, like labor pains. So again, the birth pangs, as it were, upon a woman with child, and they will not escape. So the Antichrist comes onto the scene with his bow of peace, but also conquering and to conquer. He will have a peace treaty. He will try to bring about a false peace into the world, try to set up a utopian society and have the promise of peace, but that promise of peace will be very unstable and will fall apart in a very short matter of time. As certainly as the second horse rider comes onto the scene, world war breaks out once again, and even though he conquers them, it will continue to be a struggle day in and day out in trying to rule the world, because he will not have the capacity to do so. So as we recognize and understand from Scripture that true peace is only found in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, according to James chapter 3, verses 13 through 18. And that true peace is found because of his completed work upon the cross. And specifically, when we read that passage, and I'm just going to read it for you for time purposes, in the middle of that passage, talking about true peace being found only in Jesus Christ, it also gives us an understanding of sinful man, which the Antichrist will be as well, as you know, indwelt and by the person, or possessed, I should say, by the person of Satan himself. But as it says in chapter 3, verses 14 through 16, it says, but if you have bitter jealousy and selfish ambition in your heart, do not be arrogant and so lie against the truth. This wisdom is not that which comes down from above, but is earthly, natural, demonic. For where jealousy and selfish ambition exist, there is disorder and every evil thing. And again, that's a general term for how a society can fall into degeneracy because of jealousy and selfish ambition. But that will also be the mantra of the Antichrist during the tribulational time period, which will motivate him to try to take over control of the world. But at the same time, whatever peace and safety is promised, it will be fleeting and very short-lasting, and ultimately bring about destruction onto the people of the world. And that too is a reminder that we as individuals should never put our full faith, hope, and trust into political leaders for our peace and our safety. Our peace and safety comes from our Lord above and through the blessings of God, because we are positive towards the Word of God and we are doing our job as believers in the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ to learn and grow in the grace and knowledge of Jesus Christ, again in the Word of God, and evangelize and witness to the lost and dying. When we do that, especially as a client nation collectively, then God will bring about peace and safety onto our world, as well as the freedoms and prosperity that we are currently enjoying, but again are starting to slip away. But if we turn into reversionism and go the path of apostasy, as our nation seems to be doing in large tranches these days, we're going to lose that peace and safety. And regardless of what political leader comes onto the scene and says, I'll give you peace, I'll give you safety, regardless of what they say, and regardless of what they do, because of the evil in the heart of man, there will not be peace and safety, and there will be nothing but turmoil and eventually anarchy as well. That will happen to the Antichrist during the tribulational time period, as much as he's promising peace and safety. Again, the world is going to turn against him, even in that, because all of the world will be mostly made up of unbelievers, even though there's many believers during that day and come to be saved. But remember, he's also going to kill off many Christians and Jews during that time period who have believed in the Lord Jesus Christ. So, again, the negative aspects that we see here in verses 14 and 16 are the ingredients that foil the world domination of the Antichrist during that time. It will be the initiation of him coming into power, but eventually it will lead to his full and final destruction, especially in the second advent of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And the red horse rider, again in that second seal, which again is at the early part of the tribulation, maybe towards the middle portion of it when that world war breaks out, again that will bring destruction to the world once again when man turns on man. And as the Antichrist again takes authority over that revived Roman Empire, as I've said, other kingdoms and nations will come up against him because they will not want to be under his dominion. And they will want to be autonomous and independent, or maybe even be world rulers in themselves. But yet the Antichrist will battle them and defeat them in the early portions of that tribulation and engulfing their empires as well. So, as we see, let's go to the book of Daniel, chapter 9, and verse 27 specifically. And in Daniel chapter 9, looking down at verse 24, as we get down through verse 27, we see great prophecies of the first advent of Jesus Christ, and then also the second advent of Jesus Christ. But in between that, we also have a little portion in regard to the Antichrist coming onto the scene, who will gain power for a while, but then will completely be destroyed. So, as it says, and let's go back, I'll just give you the whole thing, and then I'm not going to go into a lot of detail, but as it says, 70 weeks have been decreed for your people and your holy city to finish the transgression, to make an end of sin, to make atonement for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy place. And again, that's the 70 weeks of Daniel's vision that talks about the end or the time remaining for the Jewish dispensation. Then it says, so you are to know and to discern that from the issuing of the decree to restore and rebuild Jerusalem until Messiah, the Prince, there will be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. It will be built again with plaza and moat, even in time of distress. And that's a prophecy of the Israelites being able to go back to Jerusalem after the Babylonian captivity, after the Medo-Persians take over the Babylonian Empire, and beginning with Cyrus allowing them to go back and rebuild the temple, and then under Artaxerxes being, or in Darius and Artaxerxes being allowed to go back and rebuild the city walls as well. And that gets into the book of Nehemiah, as we've noted in the past, okay? So all of that prophecy had been fulfilled, and there was a specific time period in which they were able to go back. All right, so again, then after that, the 62 weeks, the Messiah will be cut off and have nothing, and the people of the prince who is to come will destroy the city and the sanctuary. And again, that's Jesus Christ coming into the temple, as we're reading about now. He will be cut off. He will be crucified by the people. And then, as it says, the people of the prince who is to come will destroy the city and the sanctuary. That's the prophecy of 70 AD and the destruction of the temple and Jerusalem itself. Now, it goes on to say, and its end will come with a flood, even to the end. There will be war, desolations are determined. Then in verse 27, it goes on to say, and he will make a firm covenant with the many for 1 week. And again, 1 week is 7 days, but again, a day is a year. That's the seven-year tribulation. Here we see the Antichrist coming onto the scene to make the covenant with the people of Israel. Then it goes on to say, but in the middle of the week, he will put a stop to sacrifice and grain offering, and on the wing of abomination will come one who makes desolate, even until a complete destruction, the one that is decreed is poured out on the one who makes desolate. So again, within all of that, it's talking about the Antichrist making a covenant with the Israelites for one week, which would be 7 years, the tribulational time period. In the middle, he will put a stop once they rebuild the temple. He will put a stop to the sacrifices almost immediately because they'll be sacrificing to God. And he will say, no, sacrifice unto me. And then he will be the abomination as it is, the abomination of desolation. He will say, worship me, and the Israelites will say, no, now we understand who you are, and you are not the Christ, and they will recognize who the Christ is, and then again, the Antichrist will turn on the people and bring about great destruction throughout the remaining portions of the tribulational time period. But then at the very end, it talks about a complete destruction. The one that is decreed is poured out on the one who makes desolate. The one who makes desolate is the Antichrist. He will be completely annihilated and destroyed in the second advent of our Lord Jesus Christ. Again, in the battle of Armageddon. So, when we also look at Revelation chapter 6, verse 2, we compare that with the coming in of the Antichrist, conquering and to conquer. He comes with the bow of peace, again, the peace treaty, and also the threat of warfare. So, we see the dual analogy there, and he takes power, rule, and authority. Then, when we push on in the book of Daniel to chapter 11 and verses 31 through 45, we see the war against the Antichrist by these other nations or federations that we're talking about. And as we noted, and we'll see again this evening from the north, from the south, and from the east, they will come. And they don't come from the west for two reasons, because the revived Roman Empire is technically coming from the west of Israel. And we also understand that there is no prophecy in regard to the United States of America. And for whatever reason, we are not going to be part of the tribulational time period. Again, we must be getting wiped out either through the rapture of the church and then somebody taking us over, or somehow this nation will be destroyed prior or just after the rapture of the church. So it's very interesting. We see nothing about the United States of America, the prominent nation that we are today, in the end time prophecies. Now, some also could say, well, we're part of the revived Roman Empire. Maybe that's the stretch. Maybe we could be, since we mostly came from the Anglo-Saxon regions. So, again, that's a potential. But, again, it's very unclear what happens to the United States of America during the tribulational time period. But in any case, again, in Daniel chapter 11, let's turn there now in verses 31 through 45. All right, so in Daniel chapter 11, let me get down to verse 31 here. All right, and you can read on your own a little bit beyond that. In some titles, and some, like I've got the Ryrie Study Bible, he actually has a title going all the way back to verse 21 of the Antioch Epiphanes, which was, again, the ruler who tried to take over, or did take over, Jerusalem, that was overthrown by the Maccabeans a couple hundred years before our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. But even if it was in regard to predicting that, it is more so talking about the second advent of Jesus Christ, but prior to that, the Antichrist during the tribulation. So as it reads in verse 31, because again, these things didn't happen during the overthrow of Antioch Epiphanes. In verse 31, it says, "And forces from him will arise, desecrate the sanctuary fortress and do away with the regular sacrifice. So at this point, again, the temple will be rebuilt. They will be sacrificing in the temple once again. And they will set up the abomination of desolation. Okay, so again, and forces from him will arise, and they will desecrate the sanctuary fortress and do away with the regular sacrifices. Okay, so we're not seeing a destruction of the temple. We're seeing a halting of the sacrifices that occur. And they will set up the abomination of desolation, which is an image or statue or something of the Antichrist beast during the tribulation. He will be put up in the temple so that he is the one that becomes worshipped in the temple. Now in verse 32, and they, and by smooth words, he will turn to godlessness those who act wickedly towards the covenant. But the people who know their God will display strength and take action. And again, yes, the Maccabees did that to Antioch Epiphanes, but in regard to this overall prophecy, and again, many times it's dual prophecy as we understand here. Maccabees did their thing, but at the same time, we're talking about the Antichrist and what will happen to him. All right, so it goes on to say, And again, I love with smooth words, again, the flatterer, and he will deceive godless people. Again, but the people who know their God will display strength and take action. See, they're going to reject him and say, no, you're not the Christ. You're not the God of God. You're not the great I am. And they're going to reject him, and that's when they're going to really understand that Jesus Christ was God incarnate and their Savior. Then it goes on to say, and those who have insight among the people will give understanding to the many, so they'll be witnessing and telling others. Yet they will fall by the sword and by flame, by captivity and by plunder for many days. So again, halfway through, he sets up the abomination of desolation inside the temple. Say, worship me, worship me. People who know their God are going to reject him. And ultimately, they will be persecuted and martyred. Many of them, there will be a great Holocaust during that time. Now in verse 34, it says, now when they fall, they will be granted a little help, and many will join with them in hypocrisy. So again, people will be turning against the believers of that time and joining the Antichrist. Verse 35, and some of those who have insight will fall in order to refine, purge, and make them pure until the end time, because it is still to come at the appointed time. Now in verse 36, then the king will also do as he pleases and will exalt and magnify himself above every god and will speak monstrous things against the God of gods. And he will prosper until the indignation is finished, for that which is decreed will be done. And that's the Antichrist saying that he is the God of gods. And that's the blasphemes and boastful things that he will be saying that we've seen in other passages. Verse 37, and he will show no regard for the gods of his fathers or for the desire of women, nor will he show regard for any other god, for he will magnify himself above them all. But instead, he will honor a god of fortress, a god whom his fathers did not know. He will honor him with gold, silver, costly stones, and treasures. So the god of fortress is a military might and a military power, as it were. And so he'll be worshiping military might, okay? And again, Satan being behind him and everything else that's going on as well. Now in verse 39, and he will take action against the strongest of fortresses with the help of a foreign god. He will give great honor to those who acknowledge him, and he will cause them to rule over the many and will parcel out land for a price. And at the end time, the king of the south will collide with him, and the king of the north will storm against him with chariots, with horsemen, and with many ships. And he will enter countries, overflow them, and pass through. So again, he's going to defeat and annihilate all these other countries that are coming up against him. Verse 41, he will also enter the beautiful land, that's Israel, and many countries will fall, but these will be rescued out of his hand. Edom, Moab, and the foremost of the sons of Ammon. Then he will stretch out his hand against other countries, and the land of Egypt will not escape. Again, that's from the empire of the south. But he will gain control over the hidden treasures of gold and silver and over all the precious things of Egypt and Libya, and Libyans and Ethiopians will follow at his heels. Then in verse 44, but rumors from the east and from the north will disturb him, and he will go forth with great wrath to destroy and annihilate many. And he will pitch his tents of his royal pavilion between the seas and the beautiful holy mountain, again, Jerusalem. Yet he will come to his end, and no one will help him. So, again, he will come to his end is at the second coming of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, but no one will be able to help him because, again, Jesus is going to destroy the entire world forces that come up against God and Jesus during the battle of Armageddon. And really, they're coming up against Israel, who's trying to hold on for dear life at the end, but ultimately Jesus will come back and rescue them in a fantastic warfare. So as we understand the three federations that come up against the Antichrist, as we talked about, and to give you greater detail, we have the Northern Confederacy. And as we have mentioned, again, this is led by Gog, which, as we note in understanding the ancient name of the territory and places, that this is Russia and a Russian empire or federation that is in place during the tribulational time period. And we see Gog in Ezekiel and Daniel 11, Joel, and also the book of Isaiah in those various passages. And so we see them as a northern confederation and understand their geographic location. And when we compare Scripture with Scripture, we understand that this is Russia and its allies that include Persia, which is Iran today. It also has Ethiopia and Kush, which is Sudan, or places east of Babylon as well. Again, and you know Babylon is in Iraq today. Put, which is Libya, or adjacent to Iran. Again, a different Libya that we have today, which is in North Africa, but it's a different one, adjacent to Iran. Then we have the nation called Gomer, which is Germany, which is kind of interesting, and you're seeing what's going on in our society today and how Russia is at the border of Ukraine, ready to take them over. So they will eventually conquer that land, whether it be in our lifetime or down the road. They will retake Ukraine at one point, but at the same time you see they will be leading Germany, or the Gomer of the ancient days, and having them as part of their federation. And it is interesting that there's a big pipeline going on between Russia and Germany today, and ultimately Russia will be ruling Germany one day because of the pipeline that is being put in today and the energy and economic power that they will take from them. Even though right now we look at Germany as part of the European Economic Union, okay, they are going to be part of this confederation from the north one day. And then there's another place called Beth Togarma, which is Armenia and also Turkey as well. So again, we'll see these on the map as I bring it up in just a minute. And we note that in Ezekiel chapter 38, verses 1 through 7. Then we're going to see the king of the east coming up against the Antichrist, as we again noted in Daniel 11:44. We see this again noted in Revelation 16:12. And this east talks about east of the Euphrates River, so again, Iraq and the things east of there. And it's a coalition of Asian nations. East is from, as we talk about east, it's from the Greek word entole helos. And as I said to you the other day, in the Greek, when we talk about the east, it's this combination of words which means the rising sun. And as you know, yes, the sun does come up in the east and it sets in the west. So that's where this analogy comes from. But isn't it interesting that countries like Japan, in their flag, they had the rising sun. All right. So this is the Asiatic type of nations. And again, it could be from China and all the way down into Iran. And all of those, although Iran being part of Persia, as we know, again, that being part of more of the Northern Confederacy, and we see a lot going on with Russia and Iran today. But again, those nations, even east of that, we see the Asian nations coming up as a confederation against the Antichrist during the tribulational time period. And then easily the king of the south, we see in Daniel chapter 11, verse 40, called Egypt or Sudan in the day as well. And again, that's coming from the African nations that aren't part of the Roman Empire or revived Roman Empire, if there are any in Africa that are part of the Roman Empire at that time. But in essence, coming up out of Egypt, being the head of the federation coming from the south. And so, as we noted in our map the other day, which I gave you briefly at the end of our service, again, we see the second seal warfare coming on, and it's really all designed, let me kind of get my pointer down, it's really all designed around the epicenter of Israel, and again, with Jerusalem in the center of it. But as we see these other federations coming up against the Antichrist, we see those from the north, and again, Ukraine, and up above that, as you know, is Russia. You got the Kakistans. You've got those that are around the Caspian Sea, Turkmenistan, as we have today, Turkey as well. All of those now coming down as a confederation, and they will be joining forces against the Antichrist to overcome his rule. And again, especially as he sets it up in Jerusalem to be the God of gods and setting up his not only his fortress there, but also center of worship of him. Then we'll see, again, those coming from the east, again, east of the Euphrates River. So you've got Afghanistan, Pakistan, you've got, and just behind that, as you know, you've got the Chinese Empire today, the Communist Chinese Empire, and their saber rattling that they're doing these days as well. So again, that confederation is going to come down from the east, and they're going to come up against the Antichrist there as well. And then from the south, as we said, again, from Egypt and others, you know, from the south coming up against the Antichrist. So all of them will be coming against him at one point or another, if not all at the same time, trying to defeat him. But as we said, and as we read, they will all be overthrown and they will be destroyed in their armies, or defeated, as it were. And then he will take control of their armies and of their federations as well in the establishment of his one world rule. But that too will be short-lived, because soon thereafter will be the coming of our Lord, where he will then wipe out all the world forces of the unbelieving world. So there will be, during the tribulation, the ten-king federation of nations called the revived Roman Empire that we also read about in Revelation chapter 13, verses 1 through 10. The northern confederacy of Russia and her allies, the eastern confederacy of the Asiatic countries, and then we see the North African powers as well that are coming up against the Antichrist. But all of them will be overthrown as the Antichrist conquers and conquering. And then he will establish a one world rule for a very short period of time. As we also noted in Zephaniah chapter 2, verses 8 through 15, it tells of the impending defeat and judgment of the north, south, and eastern countries by God himself at the Battle of Armageddon. And that's the second coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So at the second advent of Jesus, as prophesied in Zephaniah, not only are the Antichrist forces wiped out, but these other world forces that come up against the Antichrist that he then takes over will too be defeated at that place, because when they get defeated, they're not going to be turning to God for their salvation. They're going to be licking the boots of the Antichrist during that time and joining forces with him. And the evil that is already in them will then be multiplied in their hatred and evil against God, and certainly displayed because of the hatred and evil, the hatred towards the Israelites during that time period. And just like the world has always done, as we talked about on Tuesday, always trying to blame all their problems on Israel. It's always the Jews. It's always the Jews. And as I've also said to you, we should never be anti-Semitic in our thoughts nor in our actions as a country, because if we do, it will mean a soon destruction of our nation if we turn against the people of Israel. So in any case, during the tribulation, they are going to turn against Israel. They are going to have hatred towards them. They are going to try to wipe them out, thinking that they are the problem that is causing all the difficulties on the world. And again, a lot of that has to do with the two witnesses that will be bringing destruction and all the seal, trumpet, and bowl judgments that God brings against the world as a result of his wrath of judgments being poured out on to the unbelieving world. But before then, as we've been noting, the Antichrist will defeat them. He will solidify his world domination. Then we get into the last 3.5 years of the tribulation, as we've read in Daniel chapter 7, verses 20 through 25. So again, the first 3.5 years, peace and prosperity will be displayed. But the last 3.5 years will be a time of horrific warfare, and then also a time of world conquering by the Antichrist, and then trying to destroy both believers and Jews during that time as well. But ultimately, he will defeat the three other nation or federations that come up against him, and he will solidify his world domination during the last 3.5 year time period, and he'll try to hold on to that until the end. So the last phrase that we see in Daniel chapter 11 in verse 45, where it says he will pitch his tent of his royal pavilion between the seas and the beautiful holy mountain. Again, that's Jerusalem. Yet he will come to his end and no one will help him. So interesting enough, again, he will be left to himself and ultimately slaughtered during that time period. So this is also shown in Revelation chapter 19 in verses 11 through 21, which is that great passage of us as the wife of Jesus Christ in resurrection form, coming back with him victoriously as we come back and wipe out the world powers that are aligned against Israel and also God at the end of the tribulational time period. And that's when those other three federations will be wiped out and the Antichrist will be left to himself, and he too will be wiped out with no help from anyone whatsoever. So again, yet he will come to his end and no one will help him. So the following scriptures that I want to give you and leave you with tonight give us information in regard to the reasoning of the warfare for the second horse rider and its results. And again, the second horse rider comes early on in the tribulation. This is part of the Antichrist, again, conquering and to conquer and conquering. But then the other world forces coming up against him. World War III, as we could call it today, if there isn't another world war before this time period. But again, World War III coming to action because of the hand of the second horse rider. And it will be a horrific war. Many millions of people will be destroyed and killed during that time period, but the Antichrist will be victorious eventually in that warfare. In Ezekiel chapter 38, verses 21, it says, I will call for a sword against him, against the Antichrist, on all my mountains, declares the Lord God. Every man's sword will be against his brother. And again, just going to be warfare against warfare, and again, nation against nation. It's going to be absolutely chaotic and anarchy during that time as well. In Jeremiah 25:15, "For thus the Lord, the God of Israel, says to me, take this cup of the wine of wrath from my hand and cause all the nations to whom I send you to drink it. They will drink and stagger and go mad because of the sword that I will send among them." And remember, the second horse rider comes with the sword and brings about that warfare onto the world. And that's when World War III will happen, again, as we've described tonight. In Jeremiah 25:31, let me see if I'm keeping up. Okay, I didn't give you that, but I'll just skip to the next one. In Jeremiah 25:31, it says, "A clamor has come to the end of the earth, because the Lord has a controversy with the nations." Again, because they're unbelieving and not accepting him as God and as the Messiah. "He is entering into judgment with all flesh. As for the wicked, he has given them to the sword, declares the Lord." And again, the second horse rider is the one that's going to bring about that and enact that on to the world. And so the reason for these kinds of judgments is also noted in 2 Chronicles chapter 15, specifically in verse 4. But that reads, "But in their distress they turned to the Lord, God of Israel, and they sought him, and he let them find him." So that's why God brings these judgments to the world. Again, yes, because they're unbelievers, but it's not just a punitive judgment in all these seal, trumpet, and bowl judgments that are brought against the world. Yes, it's a judgment against the unbelieving world, but done so like a parent disciplines a child, trying to get them to wake up and get back onto a right path. In this case, they were never on the right path, but he's utilizing these things to bring them to know that only God can save them. Only God is the answer. And through these judgments, many will not believe and will continue to reject, but then many will come to salvation as a result of all that is going on. As it says in 2 Chronicles 15, verses 5 and 6, it says, "In those times there was no peace to him who went out or to him who came in. For many disturbances afflicted all the inhabitants of the land. Nation was crushed by nation and city by city, for God troubled them with every kind of distress." But again, going back to verse 4, "But in their distress they turned to the Lord God of Israel, and they sought him, and he let them find him." And that's what it's all about, so people can come to the saving knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let's turn to the book of Revelation chapter 6. Because as we're going to begin studying on Sunday, we're going to be jumping down to the sixth seal judgment, because the next thing that Luke talks about in Jesus' signs of the end times and his second coming is in regard to what is going to occur in the sixth seal judgment. And that's after the first, second, third, fourth, and fifth, as you can imagine. But again, the Antichrist and the warfare coming on and all the other things that will happen during that time, which we'll be noting in this study. But then in verse 12, it says, "And I looked when he broke the sixth seal, and there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth made of hair, and the whole moon became like blood, and the stars of the sky fell to the earth, as a fig tree casts its unripened figs when shaken by a great wind. And the sky was split apart like a scroll when it is rolled up, and every mountain and island were moved out of their places, and the kings of the earth and the great men, the commanders and the rich and the strong and every slave and free man hid themselves in the caves and among the rocks of the mountains. And they said to the mountain and to the rocks, fall on us and hide us from the presence of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of their wrath has come, and who is able to stand?" Notice how they're running to hide away from these things, they will recognize where these things are coming from, that they are coming from God and the Lord Jesus Christ. But will they come to the salvation knowledge? You see, even the demons believe in Jesus Christ, as we saw in all the exorcisms that Jesus Christ performed in his early part of his ministry. Men of the world will know that these things are only from God, especially this one when, you know, it's greater destruction than what a nuclear war could bring onto this world. Greater destruction than that. And they'll know that it is from the hand of God, but yet they still won't accept God as their Savior, and certainly not the Lord Jesus Christ. But then as we finish tonight, the promise is also made in 2 Chronicles chapter 15, verse 7, "But you be strong and do not lose courage, for there is reward for your work." So for the believer who endures, again, in our day and age, if we go through trials and tribulations and we endure faithfully, there is reward for us at the end. For the tribulational saints who continue to endure and go forward, even if they're martyred, there will be reward for them at the end and at the great end of the tribulational time period for the believer. There will be great blessing to them if they hold on and endure and do not lose faith. And remember, we even read in Daniel that some will lose their faith, but God uses that even to test their faith so that he purges out those who are unbelievers from the believers, and then therefore he is able to save and bless the believer. So a lot going on in this second sealed judgment as we see the warfare coming on to the world during the tribulational time period. As I said, on Sunday, we're going to jump down to the sixth seal, and then after that, we'll get back to the third and fourth seal judgment. So we're not going to be doing them in order because Jesus didn't give them to us in order in the Gospel of Luke. But again, we'll get them in due time. But we'll get to that sixth seal, and we'll talk about all those things that we mentioned and the great earthly destructions that happened to the world during that time. All right, so we'll close this evening. Father, we thank you for this time. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the prophecies so that we can understand and know what things lie ahead for the future. And please, Father, help us to utilize these things, not to be afraid or to have fear and worry and anxiety in our lives, but instead to gain courage, knowing your plan and also knowing your salvation for the believer, your protection, your guidance, and also, as we're going to note, how you will remove your bride prior to these things happening. So, Father, we thank you for giving us this knowledge and wisdom. And we ask that you continue to give us insight so that we can witness to those who are lost and dying in this world. Father, we pray for travel blessings on our way home this evening. In Christ's precious name, amen.